Hello, everyone. I am Perry Nemiroff, senior producer at Collider, and I am lucky enough to be your host today for Half Hour with We Were the Lucky Ones. Please join me in welcoming two of the individuals behind the limited series. Joining us today are showrunner, writer, and executive producer, Erica Lipez. Hello, Erica.
Hi, so nice to be here.
We also have author and co-executive producer, Georgia Hunter. Hello, Georgia. It's very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Thanks for having us.
Do you mind giving us a brief description of the show to start?
Yeah, I would be happy to. And Georgia can jump in if I botch it. Georgia's been doing the synopsis for like 10 years longer than me, the author of the book. But the series is about the Kurtz family, a Polish Jewish family who we meet in 1938 in their hometown of Radom, Poland. We meet them on Passover as they're sort of reunited. And then the war starts and they are flung across Europe and outside of Europe. And we've traveled with them over 9 years as they try to survive the Holocaust and reunite. We sort of simply say it's about a family who starts across the dinner table together and spends 9 years trying to get back around the dinner table together.
You nailed it. And also now we'll get to see some of that in action because we are going to begin this by showing the trailer for the series. Let's check it out.
My brother, back from Paris.
Look at you. Ooh la la.
I'd like to come to Paris.
To future adventures. I will be waiting. My family. Keep writing to them over and over. It's like I'm writing into a void.
The Germans are already at our doorstep. It's getting worse.
All of Europe is a war zone.
Let our family be our light.
We leave tonight.
I just want to be at home.
You are a Jew. Travel for you is a death sentence.
Understand the impossibility of getting home, but we will find a way to be together again.
We must organize.
We've lived here for 1,000 years. We know this country, this land.
I want to do what you're doing.
But if you get caught, it jeopardizes all of us.
I'm aware of the stakes.
You're my family. We stay together. Always.
Faith is a choice. It's an act of will. Our families are out there. The only thing I know for certain is that there's no reason I should be alive, and yet I am. And that means I have to keep going.
Georgia, my first question is going to be for you, because as we've already touched on, this is based on a book you wrote, which is inspired by your actual family's real experience. When you have material like that, what is it like finding the right people to hand it over to? What is it like looking at Erica, Thomas Kale, and the rest of the team and knowing these are the right people to handle my family story?
I feel so incredibly lucky that There was never an ounce of doubt in that transition. You know, early on in the days of writing the book, I kept it so very close for a long time. I only let my mother and my husband read it. Handing it to an agent was terrifying. But by the time I got a call from Tommy, who also is a very dear friend of mine, I've known him for 25 years. We met in 1999, and he's a dear friend of my husband's from summer camp days. Like, our friendship is so deep, and he's also, if you've ever met him, one of the kindest, most incredible human beings around. So when he called to say, let's partner to do this, or would you like to do this? It was a dream come true. And he's like, I want you to meet my friend Erica. And they had worked together in the past. And Tommy has this amazing ability of bringing, I think, the right people together. And I met Erica and I fell in love. And it was like love at first sight, first conversation. And I knew that the project had fallen into their hearts as it had in mine. And so there was, it felt so right. And so, it was just perfect. I couldn't think of a better team. And then the trickle down effect from there was incredible with our cast and all of our heads of departments and everybody involved in this show. I think we all kind of came at it with a similar mindset of kind of how I felt about trying to capture the story of my family was I just want to do it justice. And that was the refrain I heard over and over again from start to finish across the series, from top to bottom, people would come up to me all the time. We just want to do the story justice, from the writer's room, the most incredible group of writers, through to production and post-production, the gentleman in our sound studio, you know? So it was just a really remarkable feeling and a really heartwarming feeling. It all felt right. And I felt like I had so much trust in this team and so much love and respect for this team.
I'll follow up briefly on working with Tommy here, because I love the story about how the two of you met. And given how long you've known each other, I'm sure you're well aware of how talented he is. But I'm curious, in watching him direct, I believe it was the pilot and the finale of the show, is there anything you saw him do that made you stop and go, like, I knew you were good, but I never realized you were capable of doing that?
It's such a great question, because I'd only ever seen his work, you know, from the early days when he was, you know, church basements and hip hop, rap, improvised. It was really fun to watch his work. And obviously seeing his success was incredible. But for the first time, I got to see him at work behind the scenes and making something. And it was really cool because it went immediately, my brain went to, oh, camp counselor. And that's how he met my husband. He was my husband's camp counselor. And I was like, he just wants everybody to be comfortable and safe and having a good time and feel like we're all on the same page and working toward the same thing. He never takes credit for anything. He's so humble. He's such a team player. And I think if you ask anybody involved in the project what they felt of Tommy, you just hear their voices shift a little bit. I mean, it's kind of like, yeah, he's a really special human. And so getting to see him really from the very first day behind the monitor, standing next to him and watching him quietly speak to one of the cast members, it was obvious. Like, of course he was that kind of person, but it was really fun to see him in that light for the first time.
I had never really thought about how many shared qualities there are between like a director and a leader on set and a camp counselor. And it makes all the sense in the world. I love it. Erica, I want to come your way to talk about working with Georgia, because it isn't always the case when we have a book author who gets to be so heavily involved in the adaptation process. So how did you come to the conclusion that she needed to stay close to the production? And how did it impact the series for the better because she was so close to it?
I mean, it was, well, I just have to echo Georgia. Tommy is like such a matchmaker. So when I met Georgia, I just felt sort of such an instant connection. And I think we have such similarities in how we approach art and storytelling and life. And it just felt so easy. And I think when I read her brilliant book, I just knew there was no version that would not be a really faithful adaptation. I mean, she had written something that was so extraordinarily laid out, researched the depth of the characters, their connections to each other. It was all there. And, you know, but the thing you have to do when you're translating from a book to the screen is, you know, we have the privilege of getting inside people's heads on the page, and you can't do that on a television screen. So that's the piece where you're sort of activating these storylines, these memories sometimes. And making those choices with her family members and something she had worked on so closely, there just was no version where she wouldn't be close to it. I just wouldn't have felt comfortable with that. And, you know, I think the thing that we kept loose, I mean, was Georgia, we were sort of like, be part of anything you want to be part of. And she was there at the start of the writer's room, and it just never felt right to not have her be there every single day from that point on. It was just such an easy fit. The work was better. The work was richer. I think we all felt more secure in the work with her presence and her guidance. And, you know, and also there were questions coming up every single day from everyone, and that extended through production too.
Because I had read somewhere that you went into filming with something like a 300 page research packet. What was it like making the decision that everyone needed to have access to that throughout production? And can you kind of give us like the broad overview of exactly what was in that packet?
Yeah, well, the packet has become like myth legend. Our brilliant researcher Daniel was the maker of that packet, but it was all built off of Georgia's research. Like, Georgia, you spent 10 years going across the world talking to family members, and she gave us this treasure trove of information when we started. And then we built on that. And I think for each episode, I mean, it's 300 pages sounds really daunting, but actually what Daniel did that was so brilliant is for each episode takes place in a really specific chapter of history. It focused on specific characters. And as we were starting to break each episode, he would prepare a research packet that would really simply sort of give us a in-depth look at like that chapter in history, which countries we were in, what was going on in those countries, what the Quartz family might have been encountering. And part of the what was so brilliant about that is we really wanted to make sure the show always felt urgent and immediate, and that we didn't actually have that lens of history on it, that perspective that we have now looking back. I think we felt like that's a way for history to feel trapped in time and not urgent. And we felt like this piece really needed to feel urgent. And so we were sort of, so part of like Daniel's, the way he assembled it allowed us to stay very present in what the moment was of what they were encountering, and actually not to both understand context, but then also be able to kind of forget it sometimes while you're writing and really imagine what it might have felt like for them in that moment.
I am a big fan of research and over research. So this kind of stuff fascinates me to no end. And I appreciate an A+ student in this context. Georgia, for you, given all the research that you had done prior to the show even being made, prior to this packet being put together, I am curious, is there any like a seemingly small detail that you uncovered in your research that surprised you in terms of how important it was to this production?
Well, such a great question. I feel like I was constantly surprised. And I think that's because, and not by the plot or what was unfolding, because like Erica mentioned, I was really involved every step of the way. So there really weren't surprises in terms of script or direction, but I spent so long imagining these scenes and life for them before the war, during the war, just after the war, that seeing this cast embody my relatives, my, you know, Logan stepping into the shoes of my grandfather, I mean, that's a great example. That was day one on set, and we shot a little bit out of order. So it was him sitting outside of an embassy in France, the Polish embassy, trying to get permission to go home to his family after his mother had written him a letter saying it's not safe to come home, which is a true story. My grandfather didn't talk a lot about the war, but he shared a few stories, and that was one of them. And I just, you know, I'd imagined that moment, but seeing Logan's face and the torment and the hope and this angst that he held, he wasn't even speaking any lines in the moment. And I just started bawling, crying, standing behind the monitor. It was also the first time I saw what the show was going to be. I saw the lighting, I saw the costumes and the hair and the makeup. And it just all was so much more beautiful than I ever imagined. And this is my first foray into the world of television, so I didn't know what to expect. But I think it was really the dynamic, you know, the softer, quieter moments that surprised me. And then the relationship gaps between siblings, or, you know, Helena and Bella, you know, which again just really came to life in a way that was new and different from the book, and that felt so real and so relatable, you know, to I think anybody who has a sister or a best friend, parent-children dynamics, husband-wife dynamics. It was all those little moments, the looks across the table, the little quick remarks that just really bowled me over with how true they felt, and how, like, the word urgent they felt. It just felt so real time, real moment. You just forgot that history was happening. You're just living it alongside them, and this normal family seeing it through their eyes. And I think all of that really struck me.
I have to lean into the casting from there. And I wish we had time to give everybody a shout out, the time and the spotlight they deserve, because this is a big ensemble, and truly every single person shines and is really exceptional in their role. Erica, I'll get at it this way to hopefully highlight two people here. During the casting process, can you tell me which role was the easiest to fill, where it was like the right person magically appeared, but then I also want the opposite, the role that it was the toughest to find the perfect fit for, and it took some serious legwork?
I don't know. There was just felt this magic sort of obviousness to each of them when they showed up for their part. I think, of course, the person I would have to start with is Joey, because she was the one who signed on first to the project. I think we always viewed, you know, it is a big ensemble, and everyone does sort of have their moments and many moments to shine. But I think in a big ensemble, you need a way into the series. You need to give people sort of an immediate access point. And Helena, I was so struck in reading Georgia's book that, you know, how interesting it is to watch a younger sibling become a leader within the family, and a leader sort of in the survival of the family. And that just defies birth order in such an interesting way, and really defines a character, and a really interesting female character that jumped out. And she felt like such a great window into an introduction into this family. And then Logan signed on, and he just has this, you know, we knew Logan. I think what is so heartbreaking about Adi's journey is the loneliness of it. And I think, you know, I saw in George's book the opportunity to tell a story that I don't think we get to tell very often, which is the Jewish refugee story. And you know, you would need somebody that can really go on a solo journey. And, you know, he is the one separated from the family for the whole series. And you need somebody with that center, that strength, that depth of soulfulness. Also, he's a musician. I mean, I could go on and on, but I mean, when people showed up for these parts, it felt clear to me. I mean, in Georgia, I don't know what your experience, it was slightly different for you because these were your family members coming to life, but
no, you're right. When we watched the tapes, you know, I mean, Joey and Logan signed on earlier, but when we watched tapes of everybody, it just, when the right person came across our plate, it just felt right. And I feel like maybe Nahuma was the longest for us to find. And then Robin showed up and we were like,
there she is. Yeah. We should give credit. I mean, we're making it sound, our brilliant casting director, Fiona Weir, I think she would give me, like, Fiona did a lot of, like, searching and presenting, and, like, brought us these brilliant, brilliant, brilliant performers. Like, you know, we always said we need brilliant actors on screen, but even better human beings off screen, because this is a family, and this was, you know, going to be a really hard shoot, and we needed people who wanted to be part of a team. And like, this group is just the most magical group of people I've ever worked with. And I, you know, if I could work with them again, like, for the rest of my life in repertory, I would do that.
I get that feeling. We're definitely going to touch on that a little more, but first we're going to show everybody a certain someone in this ensemble in action. So let us roll a clip from the finale episode.
I wasn't trying to listen, but am I to understand you're Polish?
I like to work on my accent in America.
Do either of you know an Adi Kurz? Huh. Well, there aren't so many Poles in Rio, and I've been having trouble tracking this man down. I think we have an old address.
Probably because I moved with my wife a month ago.
You're at the courts.
What kind of trouble have you gotten yourself into?
I'm not sure, you tell me.
No trouble at all, sir. I work for the Polish consulate. We have received a telegram for you.
A telegram? Who's it from?
Well, I can't divulge that information until you come to the embassy. But the office closes in 10 minutes, so
Lizka.
Come.
I...
Go!
No, sir, no,
go!
No, you will never make it.
Run!
We are close. Come tomorrow.
Please, receive the telegram. Please. Please. I cannot wait one more night.
So I know Tommy directed that episode, but I'm wondering if either of you can speak to the prep work and the conversations that you have to have with Logan before filming something like that, because that is a moment that it needs to reflect the relief of so many years of darkness and struggle, all in like mere seconds of footage. So what kind of conversations happen before filming that?
Tommy is just so good at that, saying that one thing to an actor in their ear right before that. And that's such a private thing between director and actor. So I can't speak to that, but I can say that Logan at that point, you know, I think he had been longing for his family in the series through 8 episodes. You know, Logan also only got to act with this cast that he loves so much for one scene. So he even kind of knew that feeling just as a performer. And I just don't think much needed to be said to him at that point. I think he just knew what to do. I mean, he's also just a spectacular actor. I think Logan is one of our greatest. So
Georgia, were you there to watch that moment be filmed?
Georgia was there in many ways.
did you miss? Well, we actually had a little cameo at the end when he's running. There's a little family of 4. My husband and our 2 boys came over to Spain where we were shooting, and Logan busts through the middle of us. And I remember Tommy telling me, you could be annoyed at him, like when you turn around, because I turn as he runs through us. And I'm like, annoyed at my grandfather? And I'm like, oh, right, okay. Not my grandfather in that scene. But no, I have to agree with everything Erica said. I feel like, I'm sure, I call Tommy Yoda sometimes because he has these words of wisdom and he whispers in your ear. And I don't know what he would have said to Logan, but I am sure that Tommy also had the same sense that he was ready for that scene. Like he had been also away from his own family at this point in Romania for 9 months. And we were wrapping, we were coming to the end. It all felt very like climactic in that moment, even just in where we were in the shoot. And he nailed it. He nailed every scene too. Like it was like that literally from day one. So I'm in awe of his talent, of everybody's talent, but that quiet way he has to capture the loss and the longing and the not knowing. There really was so much weight on him in that sense. And he's not having to survive literally like trying to stay alive day to day. He's trying to have to keep the faith and the hope alive in his heart. And so that moment was so beautiful. And that is another one that my grandfather talked about, how he was sitting in a cafe in Rio and somebody overheard him speaking Polish. And I love, there's so, we could go through the series and I could name 4,000 moments that are exactly as they were described by some family member. And that was one of them. And I love that scene starts with that moment.
I think that's one of those moments in when I read it in Georgia's book, like I remember reading it for the first time, the chills and getting to like take moments like that from the page to the screen. It's like, you could not ask for anything more as a TV writer. It's just like, I'm so proud that we got to do that scene and do it in that way.
one of many very beautiful moments in the show. I wanted to go back to something I said I was going to ask you about, Erica. Could you kind of brought up how close everyone got on this set? And I've heard a lot of the cast say that in their interviews too, that it was just an especially like amazing and all around positive experience. So as a showrunner and leader here, what are some things you like to do to go about creating an on-set environment where your actors feel supported enough to tackle the tough material, but also like that journey is going to be imbued with positivity that kind of keeps them safe amidst all this?
Yeah, I think a huge part of it is about finding the right people, because if you haven't found the right people, there's only so much you can do. So we did, you know, we did make sure, like I said, it's like sort of both talent meets the human. And that was sort of everybody involved in the series. And I think the other thing, and this started back in the writer's room, because writers are always the first person on a show, and is we knew it would be really hard material. I mean, digging into the research and the real accounts from people, I mean, it's hard. And I think what we gave ourselves permission to do was find joy in it, to actually let ourselves laugh and to not feel like we weren't allowed to make jokes, laugh, keep our spirits up. And that extended to set too. I mean, this is a really, you know, we had an all Jewish ensemble, which was a really special thing too. Jews have good senses of humor usually, and this group was no exception. So there just was, and opinions, and likes to have lively, fun arguments. And there just was a lot of spirit. And I think one of the things Tommy said immediately was, we're going to get to Romania and we're going to all have dinner, just dinners, 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 dinners. And, you know, and that it's amazing what happens when you get a group of people around a dinner table together. And that's sort of what the show starts with. And that's what they're fighting for. And that's how you connect with people. And we did that, but then, I mean, you can only control so much. And I think there was some kind of magic involved in it. You know, it's like this group, they just got very close. They also all took so much responsibility for the material, you know, our cast. We had a little time to rehearse, but you know, TV moves really fast. So particularly as everyone split up and you have these like pairs on different storylines, those actors were like in their apartments every night working on material together and showing up prepared in ways that just blew my mind.
I love hearing about filmmaking teams like this. It's so special. And I feel like that quality should be apparent in, you know, some way, shape or form on literally every set out there. We have hit
I will say to anyone making a show, creating a positive environment will actually just make your job easier. So I encourage everyone to try to do that, because it's like selfish. Your job will be easier if you have a good environment. There's no reason not to.
There's like such a good point to emphasize right there. We have to end with our last question of half hour with. I'll warn you, this is a big question that feels impossible to answer, because when I looked at it, I thought of a million answers to this. I want to know for each of you, can you single out something special about your limited series that you think will make someone happy that they put it on if they check out We Were the Lucky Ones?
That is a great question. It's hard not to look at something about this chapter of history and assume like it's going to be really hard and there will be a degree of darkness. And of course there is. I mean, it's looking at one of our worst chapters of history and what human beings are capable of doing to other human beings. But I think what our show is actually about is humanity, and particularly within a family. And it's so much about the moments in between survival for this family, the moments of laughter and making music and connecting parent to child, siblings, love. And I think I am hearing from people watching the series, you know, I think it's, you may shed some tears, but a lot of them will be hopeful, happy tears. I think, you know, I think ultimately, why I fell in love with Georgia's book is, you know, is the hope. And I think I feel forever changed by getting to know the Quartz family. So I just really hope people go on the journey with them.
Well, that's so beautifully said. I agree with all of that. And I think one of the maybe surprises that comes along with a show about, if you just kind of think of it as a Holocaust show, is that it's quite different just in the reality of what happened to them, and that, you know, they didn't end up in the camps. So you're seeing a perspective that I think you don't often see with the Holocaust. They traveled across continents. You know, you're going to get scenes in Siberia and in Dakar and in Rio and, you know, literally across the globe. And so you kind of get this very global perspective of what was happening during World War II in the Holocaust, but told through this very personal lens of one family. So I think a lot of people are telling me they're just learning a lot. And then, yes, that they're so moved by the love that connects everything. I mean, the word love just keeps coming up over and over again. And the messages people are sending me of gratitude and thank you for bringing us this story of love and hope. And like Erica said, empathy. And I think now more than ever, we could use a healthy dose of empathy. So I hope it brings all of that and more.
the love and hope being the beating heart of this series was really something special. So huge congratulations on it. Thank you so much for sharing some of your experience making it with us today. I also have to say a very big thank you to Hulu. And then finally, to everyone out there watching right now, thank you so much for joining us today for Half Hour With, and be sure to spread the word about We Were the Lucky Ones.
Thank you.